Hi everyone. We'll start because it's already 11:05. So today we have with us Dr. Sanath Pathak sir, and he's been taking lectures on biostatistics at Quest Unplugged, and he also has a vast experience in research. So today he'll be covering the topics introduction to biostatistics, data collection and distribution of data. So we welcome you, sir, and you can take over from here.
Okay, so I think this is the first of this mini series, and this will be more or less a very introductory lecture. More and more details will come as the lectures progress. So this is pretty introductory. Good morning, everyone. I am Sanath, and she's already introduced me, so that's fine. Right. So biostatistics has a Pavlovian response. Does everyone know what a Pavlovian response is? Like a conditioned reflex, where the dog was taught that if he hears a bell, then he's going to be given food almost immediately, and therefore you would start salivating. So that was a conditioned reflex which got Pavlov a Nobel Prize. And unfortunately, biostatistics has become a conditioned reflex to all of us. Whenever we hear the word biostatistics, we get a conditioned reflex like this, either oh no or a cold sweat. So that is something that we would like to do away with. Break the conditioned reflex, and that way it's not really difficult. It's pretty simple. It's pretty straightforward. As long as we know what we are doing, it's not worthy of a cold sweat at all. There are some definitions. So if you go and do a search of the word biostatistics, just say what it means. It will tell you something lame like this, like a branch of statistics that deals with data related to live organisms. It's pretty obvious, right? Bio is live organisms, statistics is statistics. This definition adds nothing to you, to your knowledge. So my conditioned reflex to this definition is this, because that's just 2 minutes of my time wasted in searching. But it's given me a new term called data, which we've not been familiar with up till now. So what is data? Data is a nicer definition, and data is what we will be using when we think statistically. So simply put, data is just a collection of facts or figures. It's a collection of facts and figures. And I'll also like the second definition. They're from different sources. It's a systematic record. It's not just general any old record. It's a systematic record of a particular quantity. So that's what data is. Why is that important to us? Because what we want to do at the outset is try to differentiate data from just an experience. An experience is what you have on your own. Data is a lot of numbers, is a lot of figures. This will help us to move from a situation that most humans are in. So most humans have this preset situation to say that if I've experienced it, it must be true, right? If you must have heard this many, many times. If I've taken a multivitamin for 20 years, I have not had a cancer yet. So multivitamin prevents cancers. This is not data. This is one person's experience, and you're taking that experience and drawing conclusions. That's what this person is doing. Or I had one sandwich and then I had a headache, and that was my experience, and that becomes fact, or that becomes gospel. So what we need to do is move from experiences to data and change the way we think about experiences, right? We can convert any sort of experiences or many, many sorts of experiences to data. So there's this pretty cool project that was done by two ladies in, one in London and one in New York, called Dear Data. So they have a website called deardata.com, and they also have a book called Dear Data. And it's pretty cool. So what they've done is they just decided to take any mundane sort of experience for a week, anything, and then try to convert it into a data, then visualize that data and write it out on a postcard by hand, no need of any fancy statistical tools or computers or Excel sheets or SPSS programs necessary, just by hand simply, and then send it to the other person, right? So for example, here for 1 week, what they did was the experience was looking at the time. That's an experience we often have. We probably don't even think about it. I don't even know how many times I've looked at my watch or clock during the day. But it is an experience that I often have, or any of us usually has many times during the day. So how do you convert this into data? This experience is converted into data when it is systematically recorded. So when you have it in your mind that every time I look at my watch or look at my clock, I'm going to record it. I'm going to carry around a diary and record each and every event. And then that's basically converting into data already. But what we also can do is categorize it and label it. So, for example, what this one lady from the Dear Data project did was categorize it into, she recorded them and then she categorized it into why she looked at the time. She looked at the time on purpose because she wanted to know what the time was, or she just glanced when you're looking at your phone and or your computer and saw the time, or because she was doing this project and because she knew that she had to look at the clock, she saw this. Or because she was bored, or because it was time to eat. There are many ways of categorizing this sort of experience, which we would not do in usual circumstances if we don't really think about it, right? And then when you have this kind of record and this kind of categorization, then you can plot it, or you can make charts, you can analyze it. So this is a pretty nice looking, just aesthetically nice looking postcard that she sent the other person. This is 1 week's records of just looking at the time, nothing else. Simple experience, looking at the time. These columns are days, so M is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, from 7 a.m. when she got up till 12 at midnight. And even from this simple experience, you can know so much about that one person. You can know that she looks at the time so often only on particular days of the week in the morning when she gets up. Here, probably she gets up because she has to go to the gym or something. She gets up, looks at the time and goes away quickly and then doesn't look for an hour. Here, she's not looked at all. Maybe she was swimming or something. Here on a particular weekday, it's very boring, so she's looked many times. On a Sunday, she's pretty free, so she looked overall more times than what she does on a weekday. So much information that you can get about a life from just a visual representation of one particular experience and recording it and categorizing it. That's it. Obviously, it's not a complete replacement of your life. You cannot put a life into a record. But you can put one aspect of it into a record and glean a lot more information than what you would by just thinking of it as one experience. Right. So that's what we usually do also in the field of medicine. So it's sometimes kind of, it may sound even cruel sometimes or sad that you're taking one human and you're taking a human experience and then converting that into just an event or a number. So this was a study that we had done a few years back, where we had just a simple observational study where we had looked at outcomes in patients, children with SLE. Sorry, lot of these will come from the rheumatology spectrum. And don't worry about the specific of the disease or specifics of the treatment, etc. That might come into the examples from journals, because that really doesn't matter. What I've just taken them as examples of types of data, etc. So what we had looked at is records again of 273 patients who were followed up for about 8 years, and there were 14 deaths out of these 273. These deaths all became data points. Now these are children, these are young children. Age of onset was somewhere like 7 years and 14 years and 15 years, and they were males or females was recorded, and then how long they had the disease was recorded, and the cause of death was recorded. So it's sort of, you have to keep your mind a bit, you have to develop a bit of a rhino skin to think that such a sad event, right? I mean, such a terrible event for that family when you have a 16-year-old girl dying with lupus nephritis. She's fought for with a disease for the last 2 years or 10 years or whatever that person had, and finally she's in a hospital and she's dying and the family is devastated, and it's a horrible personal experience. But what it has turned into here is just a data point. It's just one out of 14 who have died within 273, and becomes the percentage. So it's a different way of thinking, especially in the medical field, and you have to, or you don't have to, but it's a sort of some people think that it might be less emotionally viable than thinking of each particular patient and their situations. But what it does give us is a lot of other information. It gives us a source of knowledge larger than a single experience. And that is what can help further patients, and that is what is helping science progress. If you just thought of those 14 people as very sad events and maybe help the families and let them go, then you would have done your duty towards your patients, but I mean, it would have stopped there. It would not have informed anything further, right? So here, what you're doing when you're converting these experiences into data, keeping a stone on your heart, is you're trying to glean more and more information from this. So then you analyze these 14 patients, say, what are the variables? What are the predictors of death? Who is more likely to die? Who is more likely to have more severe disease? What are the causes of deaths? What were the causes of deaths in most, for example? And then that gives you information to be used in a future patient. Your eyes and minds are open. You have a pre-test probability, or you have a prior picture in your head. So if next time you get a patient like the first one, so if you get a patient who's had a early onset, who's had a stroke, who now has kidney disease, you are probably going to be a little more aggressive in treatment. You're probably going to monitor them more closely. You're probably going to tell the parents that, you know, any small event should bring you to the hospital. It is going to benefit someone else apart from that one person and apart from you. So that is the main point of converting an experience into data. To get a source of knowledge larger than one experience. This is not free of problems. It's not just that you can convert any sort of event into data. Measurement is often difficult. Very simple things, right? Now, this doesn't seem like a difficult problem at all. I mean, as long as you have the resources to do it. What is the prevalence of blindness in the state of Maharashtra, right? I mean, even if you could go into every household and check the vision of each and every person, there is still ambivalence. There is still different definitions. The World Health Organization defines blindness as a visual acuity of less than 3/60. The National Program for the Control of Blindness defines a vision less than or equal to 6/60 as blindness. Then there are various different definitions of blindness. There's social blindness, which has a different term. There's manifest blindness. There's absolute blindness where they can't even see anything. There's economic blindness where they can't earn because of their lack of sight. And you don't know which one to use. And one study might have used the WHO definition, the other study might have used the NPCP definition, the third study might be looking at just economic blindness. There's just a lot of ambivalence in data. So it's not that straightforward. There's also a lot of subjectivity. You can just convert even subjective feelings into data. You can just ask, how happy do you feel in the last week? And you can give them, a visual analog scale. Mark how happy you are between 0 and 10, right? And I might think I was very happy in the last week. So I can mark myself an 8. Or in fact, I might think that I wasn't happy at all. I had to spend a Sunday reading biostatistics. So then I can mark a 3 or 2, depending on what I'm feeling during different thoughts in the same minute. And I might think that I'm happy at 7, and my sister might think that she is happy, but happiness only means 6 because you can't really be very happy. So it's very subjective, and you don't really know how best to analyze it. So even if we say that converting experiences into data, any sort of experiences can be converted into data, is possible, it's definitely not easy and needs very rigorous definitions. And it needs definitions for a particular purpose. So now if I'm doing a study, what I need to do right at the start is define how I'm going to define blindness, right? So right at the start, I need to say that I am going to take a WHO definition with an acuity of vision less than 3 or an inability to count fingers. That's it. I mean, I don't care what the other definitions are. I don't care how other people might construe this definition. They might not think it's relevant here. The WHO definition is very general, they might think, but doesn't matter. I have to be rigorous at the time of deciding to collect data itself. So that is why there are two limitations to data as a source of knowledge, as opposed to experiences. The first one is, as I said, it's an imperfect measure of what is being measured. Just looking at the time that Georgia Lupi did does not really give you how her week was. It does give you some information. It gives you a lot of information, in fact, and gives you patterns. How happy a person felt or how happy this person felt, does that only in the last week, does that give you what you're looking for? Like how well a complete nation is doing? How much ever you do, however well you collect data, however well you store data, it's still going to be an imperfect measure of what you want to be measured. The second problem, and that's what statistics is all about, as you will go to in the subsequent lectures, I'm not going into that part now, is the problem of random variability. So if I take a poll of happiness of 1,000 people and I get some value, and if I take a poll of happiness of the same 1,000 people on the next day, I might get a different value. If I take a poll of another 1,000 people, I might get a different value. So there are going to be differences in person to person and time to time. And like I said, my definition of happiness is different, and my sister's definition of happiness is different, and my definition of happiness is different in the morning, and it's different in the evening. So there is going to be some variability within myself or within the normal data, And what statistics will try to do is try to see if a variability that is seen in an experiment or in a question can be explained just by random variability. Can it just be explained by chance, or it cannot be explained by chance? Is there a different difference in that particular group? Is a lot of what statistics will try to do, and that is probably what you'll be learning in the next lecture, right? So what statistics will do for us is first provide a basis for the interpretation of data, and secondly, it will try to distinguish important relationships. It will try to see if there's a correlation. It will try to see if there's a difference between two groups, which is not explained by just plain, simple, mundane background variability. Fine. So just a brief slide about where we are. So statistics as a science came up in the 16th to 18th century. Why? Because then was the time when a couple of people, especially, but then a lot of workers, looked at the science of probability. And they found that probability could provide a mathematical basis for saying if something is naturally variable or something is not naturally variable. So I'm not going into that. And Victorian England was a hotbed of measurements. They've just measured everything. They've measured body lengths and body sizes and plants and categorized them and gone on voyages and collected specimens and collected different animals and things. I mean, it was a period rife for recording measurements. That was a national or international obsession at that time. And that's when the science of data sort of got popularized. It wasn't called it then. What it has come to now, unfortunately, is, and what gives us that Pavlovian response of either boredom or fear or shock when we hear of biostatistics, is that we think of biostatistics just as a bag of tools and not as a problem solving mechanism. When it's just a bag of tools, then it's a lot of tests, it's a lot of names, Pearsons and Spearman and whatnot else, biostatisticians from earlier centuries that we have to mug up, or student, and then what tests they came up with and how they are used, etc. And therefore, we try to segregate all what we think from this bag of tools and leave this to the statisticians as a separate entity. But more and more, as we go into the next years or the next phase, you must have heard this term many, many times, called big data, data science, data dredging. They are all over media. So big data is where you get enormous data sets. Every time you like a Facebook post, it gets stored somewhere as a data variable. Every time you put a hashtag yellow on Instagram, you know it's getting stored somewhere and it's searchable. You put a hashtag yellow in your search column and then there are 1.5 or 2 million hashtag yellows, right? Or Twitter, you can, is segregating things. Traffic signals are segregating things. It can transmit data directly to computers. It can say how long it was red, how long it was green, how many people broke the signal from cameras attached to traffic signals. There are more and more and more and more billions and billions of data points being stored every day at every second, or even microsecond. So it becomes more and more difficult or more and more important to know how to analyze this, because just numbers don't tell you anything. You have to put a voice to the numbers and you have to put them in perspective to get some information out of them. Right? So a good way to do it for us who are going to use statistics is take it problem by problem. So think of statistics as a problem solving tool rather than just a bag of tools for something else, for someone else to do. Okay, so that of course then has to start with the problem, and the like data, you have to understand and define the problem. Filter it down to one sentence or two sentences or three sentences, but that brings clarity to your mind about what the problem is. And then that also tells you how we think we might be able to answer it without really going into t-tests and chi-square tests and things at this moment. Then when we sort of know how we are going to answer it, that also tells us what kind of data we want to measure. So if our problem is to look at blindness in the state of Maharashtra, we define the problem, and then we define what how we answer it is just a simple cross-sectional study. The how is not very difficult in this kind of situation. Doesn't really need rocket science. But then what you need is a plan. What will you measure? How will you define blindness? How will you go to houses? What instrument will you use? What kind of design that we've already said? How will you record it? If you are going to use Anganwadi workers to go into every household to look at finger counting, it's fair enough that you use only finger counting, but if that's your plan and that's your definition, then that's written already. How will the Anganwadi workers record it? How are you sure they don't misplace the sheets? How are you sure they'll take on every person? How are you sure that those sheets will come to the primary healthcare center, wherever your nodal point is? So that is when your data collection comes in, data management comes in. How will it be entered into an Excel sheet? How are you sure that this is not incorrect entry? And then after that comes what we only think of when we think of the word biostatistics. So that the data needs to now get sorted, and then simple graphs and what kind of patterns that you see. And now you can do the kind of analysis that you've decided right here. So you've already sort of decided what the problem is and how you're going to answer it. So then here it's not difficult. All it needs often is technical knowledge of using computer programs. And also keep your mind open here, because what you might see is patterns that you haven't seen before. So if you've defined a problem and you see an answer coming out which is completely counterintuitive to what you thought. If you thought that cities will have less blindness as compared to rural areas because they have good access to healthcare, and here once you start analyzing and you see patterns that cities have a lot of blindness, then you look at these patterns and you get more and more hypotheses. So it's sort of a self-feeding loop. So while you make conclusions from this particular study, what you also get when you do it in a problem cycle, solving cycle way, is that you get new ideas. A new idea that cities have a higher prevalence of blindness. So then that becomes your new problem. Why is an urban area associated with a higher prevalence of blindness, right? So then you might want to look at possible explanations: more pollution, worse water, rapid aging, anything, more a higher prevalence of diabetes, producing higher diabetic retinopathy. You tend to think of more and more hypotheses, and then you again go to the problem to understand and define it. So problem solving cycle is what is useful. It's useful not to concentrate on biostatistics only in the analysis part. Everything is what you will be doing when you think biostatistically or when you think in data terminology. So what is a variable? More and more definitions, sorry. But these are pretty simple definitions. So a variable is anything that can be codified and can be given more than a single value. So if something has a single value, it's called a constant. It's in the word, it's in the language itself. You don't really need to have some great knowledge of statistics to come to this conclusion that if something has only a single value. So if you've done a study of prostate cancer in males, over the age of 60 years. Age can be variable because over the age of 60 years, so they might be 65 or 70 or 80. But gender here is constant in this particular study. It's not a variable because all of them are males. And so it has only a single value, which is male, right? So anything more than a single value is variable. So anything more than a single value, you can even have just two values. So if you have two values, 0 and 1 or 0 and 2, it's called a binary variable, right? So if you go to a Starbucks, for example, you have 20 different coffees when you are handed out a menu and you have to choose from one of those. But instead, if I go to the tea wala, the chai wala next to me on the street, he has one sort of tea. So what is the decision that I have to make? I don't have to make the decision between mocha latte and tall and short and grand and whatnot. I have only one decision to make. Do I want that tea that he's offering or do I not want it? So that is a binary decision. Yes or no. 0 or 1, that's it. So a lot of binary variables are used very often. Often you will see binary variables being used in clinical trials. So for example, this was a trial published this year itself in the New England Journal, where they've used a particular type of drug in a particular type of cancer in children. Right? You don't need to really go into the details of what drug and what cancer, etc. But they have made two groups out of those 300 of about 150 each. But look at the outcomes. The outcomes are event-free survival and death. So event-free survival was already defined, like how we wanted to define it right at the start. Event-free survival is defined that if they've not had so-and-so things, they didn't have any hospital admissions, they didn't have anything else. I mean, I'm not telling you all of those, but it was defined. So what kind of variable is this? So event-free survival, did they have an event-free survival or did they not have an event-free survival? 93% had an event-free survival in the rituximab group and 7% didn't. So this is a binary variable. It's very, very commonly used as outcome. It's very easy to use as outcome because it makes analysis very pretty simple. And it makes, it puts things into perspective. Death is also a binary outcome. If a person is dead or he's alive, it's just yes or no. You can't be half dead or half alive. And so there were 8 deaths and 20 deaths in the group which did not get the drug, right? So binary outcomes are commonly used. They are convenient to use, but you have to make them binary. So you have to convert survival or a period of treatment into either yes or no or into a death or no death. Those are used. But you might have sometimes more than one. You might need to group them into categories. And often the categories don't have any particular order. So if you are going and getting a new scooter, for example, you are given a choice between 6 colors and they are not really ordered. I mean, completely according to personal preference, I might prefer a dark blue one. My sister might prefer a red one or a yellow one or a blue one, whichever. So a blue is not higher than yellow, a red is not higher than silver. So this is non-ordered categories, right? So you have 6, you have scooter color as a variable. And the variable has 6 possible categories or 6 possible values, blue, red, green, not green, yellow, light blue, etc. But one category is not higher than other. So this is called a categorical variable where they are not ordered. Male, female genders are, I mean, they are on the same level, they are not hierarchical that way. Geographical variables, urban or rural, or even like in a study, if someone is in arm 1 or someone is in arm 2, I mean, that's fine. They're just in two separate arms. One is not higher than the other. Right? So they're just grouped into separate categories. The categories are, known by name. So here the names are male, female, or transgender. Or here the names are red, blue, or yellow. So when something is known by a name, the adjective used for it is nominal. So these are nominal categorical variables, which don't have a natural order. So sometimes you might find numbers or you might find categories itself and they are in a natural order, but that number doesn't really mean anything. So for example, Forbes magazine publishes every year the list of the richest people in the world. So it's a ranking. Jeff Bezos was richest this year, continues to be. So you have a hierarchy here. Jeff Bezos is richer than Bill Gates, who's richer than this person, I don't know how to pronounce his name, and I mean, he's French, so I stay away from pronunciation. And then who's richer than Mark Zuckerberg, at least in the last year. But, and you know that one is higher than two and two is higher than three, but that's all the information that gives you. All it tells you is that these are separate categories in a natural order, but you don't know how much more money Jeff Bezos has as compared to Bill Gates. You don't know if how many times more money someone has as compared to the next one. So there's no real other information. You can't do anything with those numbers. So those numbers are actually just names. They are not amenable to either counting or amenable to any mathematics further. So this is also a categorical variable, but in a hierarchy or a natural order. And because it's an order, you would categorize this as an ordinal variable. Okay, so these are the two types of categorical variables. So ordinal scales are often also commonly used. So like we had binary outcome variables in our clinical trial. It's a crime these days to not talk of COVID. So let me take a COVID-related trial. So this is a drug that they tried to use in severe COVID-19 disease. It was a multicenter trial in China. Again, they've divided 230 patients into two groups and look at the outcome. So the outcome is an ordinal scale between 1 to 6, and that they've measured at day 7, 14, and 28. This was published just last month in The Lancet. So here they are in a hierarchy. I mean, it's intuitive to you. You don't really need to say that death is worse than mechanical ventilation or extracorporeal oxygenation, which is worse than non-invasive ventilation, or high flow oxygen, which is worse than just oxygen, which is worse than being in a hospital without oxygen, which is worse than being at home, right? But that's it. I mean, those numbers don't tell you anything else. Can you multiply them? Is three people who are discharged equivalent to one person who is in the hospital on oxygen? No. Is two people who are dead equivalent to one person? Is two people who are on oxygen equivalent to one person who died? No. So the numbers you can't do anything with except knowing that they are just names and they are in order. So this is the kind of ordinal categorical variable that can be used in a randomized control trial. Okay. And then you can have data as numbers. So these were just names or these were categories, but you can have data as actual numbers. And they can be something as simple as counts. So if you just wanted to see the number of murders in the country in the last years, these are counts. I mean, you can multiply them, you can subtract them. In the last year, in 2018, there were 41,000 murders in India. And you know that there are 5,000 more or less than what one saw in 2007 when there were 45,000. So you do know that they have gone down by about 10% when you can say that they're for 4,000 less. So you can make some sort of mathematical conclusions when you're counting, even when you can't have fractions in between. So you can't have a 0.5 murder, or you can't have 0.75 murder and 0.25 not murder. So these are discrete variables where you're counting something and you can only get integers and you can only get positive numbers. You cannot get fractions and you cannot get any, just any value on a scale, right? And compare this to something like what you can measure with an instrument. So something like height, where you theoretically you can measure to 0.1 or 0.01 or 0.0001, depending on what kind of scale you're using. Just because measuring scale limits itself to a particular smallest fraction of 0.1 doesn't mean that you can't measure height to the nearest 0.00001. So theoretically you can. So you height can have any value on a particular scale. So can bone mineral density, where the machine, the DEXA scanner, will give you a number of something something point something something gram per meter cube of bone as calcium. So bone mineral is given as a variable which is on a scale which can get any value, and these are numerical variables, right? So when you look at studies, you will see all of these being used in a particular study often. I mean, so if you look at this same trial, just revising the types of variables that we've seen, either you have categorical, which are known only by their names and or categories, and if they are not really in order, they are called nominal, and if they are in order like that scale, they are called ordinal. And numerical are either discrete, where you can only have integers, and you can have continuous if you variables where you measure things. So here, for example, sex, men or women, is just binary. So men, yes or no, right? So 89 out of those, whatever, 158 said yes, so 56%. Comorbidities, yes or no, again binary. Coronary heart disease, yes or no, again binary, with a pre-specified definition. Coronary heart disease, you might have 10 different types. You might have unstable angina in one, and a frank myocardial infarction in the other, but doesn't matter. All that matters here is if it fits, or if that person fits into your previously defined definition of coronary heart disease. And if he does, it's a yes, and he comes into those 15 out of 158. If he doesn't, then it's a no. Body temperature, what kind of variable is it? Body temperature can be measured by a thermometer, and theoretically you can measure any, I mean, you can measure it to the smallest fraction possible. So body temperature here is a continuous numerical variable. Fever is again yes or no. Respiratory rate is usually a discrete variable, right? So I might have 15 breaths and you might have 30 breaths, and usually you don't really count something like 15.1 or 15.2 even if the minute gets over. So it's a discrete variable, but look how it's handled here. So a respiratory rate, which was a discrete variable when it was recorded, has been converted into a binary variable. So now they've only divided people into two categories based on the respiratory rate. So if you have a respiratory rate more than 24 breaths or less than 24 breaths, so it's yes or no. So more than 24 breaths, yes. So 36 said out of 158 said yes in the remdesivir group, and 11 said yes in the placebo group, right? So again, they've done the same thing with serum creatinine. Creatinine is a continuous numerical variable. You can measure it. It comes on a scale of micromole per liter. But here again, they have made, according to that value, converted it into two categories, just for the ease of analysis and the ease of understanding for the reader, that 98% had normal creatinine levels in the remdesivir group, whereas 97% had normal creatinine levels in the placebo group. So I'm not really concerned about the differences between the two. We are only doing this exercise to see what different kinds of variables are used in a research study which was published this year. So we've used all sorts of variables. Why is it important to know? Because how you analyze them or how you represent them will change. So categorical data, when you have only names or when you have only a scale, all you can do is really tell what proportion each category has, which is not, I mean, I'm in no way detracting from the information that it gives. It's very important information. So like a scooter company might say that in the last year we had maximum sale of silver scooters and yellow scooters are not really being sold. So that might change the strategy, but all that their data has given them, because it is a categorical value, is a percent or a proportion. So about 40% of sales were silver scooters. So next year's paint ordering will order more silver paint, and they might already have yellow paint left over from last year, so they don't really need to order more yellow paint. All of these decisions can be based on simple data like this, right? It does not need to be any fancy data. It does not need to have any fancy tests applied to it. You can get a lot of information. So even when it's an ordinal scale, so this is again from the same paper, the Lancet paper. Sorry, does anybody need to say something? I heard something. Okay. I can't see the screen. I'm seeing my own slides. Okay, sorry. So, again, with the ordinal scale, you can have percentages, but that's sort of what you can have, but that still tells you a lot. So, 25% of people in one category were alive, and 23% of people in the other category were alive and had been discharged. So it doesn't really make too much difference. Or the number of people who died in the remdesivir group was 15, which was 10%, and 9% in the placebo group. So again, intuitively, I mean, you will be applying statistics to know whether this is just by random chance, this 1% difference between 10% and 9% can be explained just by random chance, or it can't. So that is what your next lecture will be. But basically, intuitively, it tells you that really, frankly, there's not much difference. I mean, even if there's a small difference, that's okay. There's not really a 30% versus 5% difference in the number of people dying. So it's not, even if it is, it's not going to be some great magic drug, at least from the data that you have from this trial, right? But numerical data, you can do lots of other things with. So this was a very interesting figure called Sir Francis Galton. And his motto in life was, if you can, count it. So you just count things. So there was a competition where in a fair in a place that he lived close to that, where an ox was kept, and what people had to do was take a visual estimate of how much that ox might be weighing, right? That's all that people, that's a pretty simple thing. And about 800 people participated. They put in cards with their estimates of how much they thought the ox must be weighing. What Galton did, I mean, instead of putting in his own estimate, was take all these cards and analyze them. So what kind of data was this? An estimate of an ox's weight. Yeah, so I mean, it wasn't measured, it was thought of in the mind, but a weight would be a continuous variable. That's fine. So what he looked at was this. So he didn't have any estimate of himself. He didn't know how much the ox weighed either. But he looked at all the cards and just put them in order. And took out the median one I mean, the median was the central one. So there were about 50% observations below it and 50% observations above it. And said that the voice of the people, just combining all data, tells me that the weight of the ox is around 1200 pounds. LBs is pounds, so 1200 pounds. The real weight was 1198, so it was remarkably close. Right. So not knowing anything about the people who are looking at it, not knowing anything about how they have measured or visually measured, or how they have guessed, or how intelligent they were, or how scientific their guesses was, you don't really need anything. All that he could say was that the voice of 800 people was much, much better than the voice of one person. In most cases, so only about 10% would be close to this 1200 figure. The rest varied from 1000 to 1300 pounds, right? So many individual people were wrong, but the voice of the people, or the vox populi, was correct. But what he ended up doing here was basically summarize the data into one particular number. So what he did was bring all of this 800 estimates into one median and show that the median was a very good estimate of what was actually true. The true weight of the ox was 1198. Right. So you can reduce a lot of numbers to a summary. So this was a similar kind of thing. Again, a modern version of taking the voice of the people. This, the gentleman to the right, is a statistician called Sir David Spiegelhalter in the UK, and on YouTube he had a challenge of this. He showed this particular jar full of jelly beans and asked, just by visually, people to write in the comments about how many jelly beans they estimate it to be. And people might have thought differently. I mean, just without even thinking, they might have just written down something, or they might have calculated the number, measured the number that you see in one face and then multiplied by six, or then calculate the length of each jelly bean sort of, and then think how many might be there in that volume. Very, very different ways of answering this question, from very lay to very erudite. But anyway, I mean, 1,000 people answered, 900 and something people answered. And then what he had was the data from 1,000 observations, right? So when you have data from 1,000 observations and it's numerical data, you can summarize it and you can look at its distribution and how people have estimated it and how they have been thinking. So if there's various ways of visualizing data, this kind of data. So here the easiest was just to do a scatter plot. Each data point, each observation, he just put on a plot. That's it. That's all. And even that gives you so much information. It gives you that most people are, so in this scale you can see 0, 10,000, 20,000, 30,000. So most people have guessed between 0 and 5,000, or most people in fact have guessed between 0 and 3,000. And there were, I think, about 3,000 about 2,000 jelly beans in that jar, but that's besides the point. We are looking at what kind of answers he got and how to analyze that data. So you can see just by looking at it that most people have guessed here, but some people have guessed bizarre numbers. Like this one chap has thought that there were 35,000 jelly beans when most other people have guessed 1500. This person has thought there are 20 something thousand. These few people have thought that there were 15,000 or 12,000. So they were way off the mark, of course, but there have been answers like that. And then some figures seem to be pretty popular. Like we have a thing probably for round numbers. So look at this. Like many people have thought that there were 10,000. So even if there were actually much less than 10,000, quite a few people have thought that there are 10,000 jelly beans within that jar, right? Or if you can, like a data, like a scatter plot, if you want to make it even cleaner, then you can put it into a histogram where you look at the frequencies of the number of observations within that particular group. And then most people have given this observation, and some people have given this these observations below 5,000. But then you have a few who have given this one observation, and you have one or two funny people who've given observations more than 10,000 or 20,000, etc. So what kind of data distribution is this? So just because of these people, the data becomes skewed. So it becomes skewed to the right because you have a few very, very large observations, and that's pretty common. But what it gives us the opportunity is to describe this distribution, and describe the data in a very few summary statistics. Summarize the data in only a few numbers. So the number of jelly beans in a jar, mean is the actual average. So you take data points from all of these and then add all of them and then divide them by 900. And imagine that just because of this one, most of them are 1500, and because of this 30,000, that entire mean gets shifted to the right. So when it's such skewed data, the mean is not a great idea to use. The median is more useful. So when it was around 1800 or something, the median is closest. Median is what Sir Francis Galton had done, that he had taken the exact central value. So there are 50% people below it, 50% people above it. And what you're taking is the average voice, the central voice of the people. So when it is skewed data, the median is more useful. The mode is just the highest number of times a particular observation has been said. So here you can see that the mode is pretty susceptible to irrationality, right? When all of us know, and most people know, like 97% people know that it is below 5,000. Just because a lot of people thought that 10,000 is a very cool number and it sounds just right to us, and because there are lots of zeros and one very nice round number, many people ended up saying 10,000 and became the mode when it was grossly off. A range is also useful, but it doesn't tell you much apart from what people have thought, from 219 to 311 337. So it is very susceptible to outliers, like the 30,000 person. What is more useful is using an interquartile range, especially when there's a skewed data. So what you're using is where the central 50% observations lie. So the central 50% observations will take out some of these and take out a lot of these, and therefore it narrow down the variation to a much narrower. So it's easier to guess what the number of data will be and what the spread is like from an interquartile range than just from a range. And a standard deviation is something that we use in normal data, which can be utilized mathematically, and which you will probably be using in the subsequent lectures. Just to say that just because we've heard that normal distribution is common, it doesn't say that every data is normally distributed. So normal distribution is the most common on most variables in the world. But so, for example, this data is not a normal distribution. This is a skewed distribution to the right. So any assumptions that you'll use for statistical testing, which assumes it as normal data, will not be used for this, or should not be used for analyzing this particular data. Or in other you can convert it, you can do a log transformation, or you can take out all the outliers, you can decide such kinds of things before doing testing. So again, I'm not going into that. There are other kinds of distributions. There's a uniform distribution. So say you have an army, and you decide that each squadron should have the same number of people right at this time of recruitment. So squadron 1 has 100 people, squadron 2 has 100 people, squadron 3 has 100 people, squadron 4 has 100 people. So this is not a normal distribution. This is a pretty artificial distribution, and it is uniform. Right? There are different distributions. There's a binomial distribution, there's a exponential distribution, there's a T distribution, which is sort of like the normal distribution but more amenable to testing. So lots of other distributions. Just to introduce these terms, we don't really need to go into these right now, but just to say that it's not sine qua non that all data will be normally distributed. Right. Finally, I'm just coming to the question of why are we really looking at data? I mean, what's the point of spending these considerable resources in doing a study, thinking of a question, taking a sample, going and collecting data, recording it, analyzing it, etc., etc.? Why are we really looking at it? So look at this kind of headline, which it come. I think this has come in the Business Times, where it talks about India ranking poorly in a happiness report. So since we've been talking about measuring happiness in various visual analog scales, I've continued that in that stream. So it says that Finland is really high in the happiness report. India ranks much, much lower, and it's lower than what it was 5 years ago. That was the kind of headline that the media will come to. But what is this headline based on? This headline is based on a document called the World Happiness Report, which is published every year by an organization comprised of many groups. And in turn, the World Happiness Report, apart from many other things like life expectancy and urban-rural divide and a few other things, depends on simple surveys like the kind that we asked people. How happy are you feeling? So the organization that sort of devised surveys and does a lot of surveys all over the world is called Gallup. So you might have even heard the term Gallup surveys. So the World Happiness Report takes into consideration Gallup surveys, and depending on the size of the country, all the number that is a number of people that is being asked is about 1,000 to 2,000, right? So in larger countries, the US, China, India, etc., Gallup calls up 2,000 people, takes about a half hour telephonic interview, and asks them about happiness. And it has a whole procedure about what kind of people it calls and from which sort of sectors, and how it will divide and how it will grade their answers and how it will record the answers. All that is very well defined. But basically, what this survey is giving us is information about 2,000 people. That's it, right? So why we look at data, or when we do this kind of experiment, is we get data from 2,000 people. Next, we need to extrapolate it to the sample. The sample is the people who are telephoned. Is the data that we have recorded in our computer and what we've analyzed representative of the sample? In turn, we need to say that is the sample representative of the study population? The study population in this particular example for it is people with telephones at home, and who are at home, sitting at home with a half an hour to spare and don't brush away a person who is calling to say, will you give your next 30 minutes to answer random questions about happiness, right? So that's the study population. And then does that really tell us information about the target population, which is the entire country, which is what this headline is telling us? So when this is a pretty sweeping statement, right? India ranks poorly. So the target population is the entire country. So from this little survey of 2000 people answering questions on a telephone for 30 minutes, we are directly going to conclusions about their entire country, right? You have different steps. So from data to say, if your data is giving reliable information about the sample, you need to say, is there a problem of measurement? How much variability? Have you recorded it correctly? If you haven't recorded it correctly, if you have made a lot of errors in writing the data, then you can't even talk about your own sample. And then if you want to go from step two to step three, you need to say that, is the sample giving you enough information about the study population? Have you only chosen urban people? Have you only chosen old people? Have you only chosen more females? Is it representative? So your sampling methodology matters a lot. And finally, does the study population give, is it okay to give you information about the target population? Is it okay to say that asking only people with telephones who are sitting at home in the middle of the day, can you make conclusions about the entire country based on that? So this is basically what statistics will try to do, is that a process called inductive reasoning. So we've heard about deduction many times. That's what Sherlock Holmes and all these detectives do. So what they do is take general ideas, rules of logic, and take it to a particular conclusion. So they know a general idea is that if you're sitting on the right side in a horse cart, then your right-sided shoe will probably get more soil than the left side. And then they look at that person and say that, oh, your right shoe has mud on it. So that's why I have deduced that you were sitting on the right side of the cart. That's what Sherlock Holmes does. What we do with data or what we do with statistics is the exact opposite. So what we are taking is particular conclusions from our data, from our 1,000 people, and doing not deduction, but induction. Inductive reasoning to say that, can we say that what we found in this 1,000 people is true for the entire population or the population of interest? So what we are actually doing is not Sherlocking, we are anti-Sherlocking, right? I've taken a lot of things from these very excellent books, The Art of Statistics by Sir David Spiegelhauer. This was is not there anymore.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the lovely session. So we have a few questions. So should I start asking?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first question is, what are some elementary statistical methods?
Some elementary statistical methods?
Yeah.
As in, we need a little more articulation on the question, because it depends on what you want to do on the statistics. So anything is a statistical method. Just recording something and finding out a proportion is a statistical method. It doesn't really, we have this thing in our mind that statistics is equivalent to finding out differences in between two groups. I mean, that, although that's a commonly used statistical, application in medicine, that doesn't really hold true at all. I mean, you have various different, so anything from just counting is a statistical method. So, I mean, I would call that elementary. I'm not sure what this, what the asker wants.
Okay, no problem. So, our next question is, how is a skewed distribution curve analyzed? Since methods used for normal distribution curve can't be used effectively, do we convert them into binary variables?
So, I mean, it depends on, you will hear this answer from me many times, but it depends on what you want to look at. So, the analysis methodologies for normal distributions, only some of them are particularly used for that. So, I mean, doing a standard deviation or normalization, what is called doing a Z-score, etc. Those are the things that you can't do with distributions. Then, often what you would do with skewed distributions is use slightly different tests as compared to some which are completely normal with slightly different assumptions. So you may not use the student's t-test, for example, if it's a skewed distribution. Or as has been suggested, you might want to take out the outlier variables and then convert it into a normal distribution. Although that's not really advised because then you're taking out valuable information. Or you might convert it into a different scale. So if you convert, say, a skewed distribution into a logarithmic scale, then it becomes narrower.
Okay.
So there are ways to handle it.
Okay, sir. Next out is, does skewed distribution mean there is a bias in the study?
In the study? No, not at all. I mean, you might have skewed distribution just by the virtue of the actual data you're gathering. So, for example, if you can you tell me what a skewed distribution means? So, can anybody tell me what a right word skew means?
Oh, you guys can put it up in the chat box.
Yeah. Is anybody answering? Okay, so right. So when the mean, mode we are not really concerned with, but yeah, when the mean and median don't coincide, correct, Avnika is right. So a positive skew will mean that the median is higher than the mean, right? So if, it completely depends on the data. So if you say that I will measure the number of legs that humans have in a particular city, okay, so then you will have about 99.99% with two legs, and you might have 0.1% with one leg, and you might have even a smaller number with zero legs. So what this does is it brings your mean down, because your mean becomes less than two when the vast majority of nearly everyone has two legs. So it really depends on what kind of data you're gathering, and most places you can't help but get a skew. So things like income and are grossly skewed. Like most people lie within a particular income range, and then there are very, very few people who are stratospherically higher than like these billionaires. There are only 30 or 40 people out of a billion who are above a particular range. So, some things are inherently skewed. It doesn't really have to say that your study was done improperly or that the study was biased at all.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir. Our next question is, what exactly is continuous data and what all is included in it?
What exactly is
continuous data?
Right. So continuous data is, as I said, numerical data. We have two different types. Numerical data is when you're measuring a number. What you're measuring is a number. But some numbers are not continuous. So they're only discrete. So you can only count. So if you're counting the number of people, there's either one or four, two or three or four. They can't be 1.1 or 1.3 people, right? So, but continuous data, theoretically at least, your data point can lie anywhere on that scale. So, say your height, if you're measuring, or your weight, if you're measuring, I can have a person with a weight of 87.4. I can have a person with a weight of 87.42. I can have a person with an 87.4234. Theoretically, I mean, regardless of the fact that my weighing scale might be rounding it up to the nearest integer, that's also possible. But still, that data is continuous because theoretically, you can have any value in that particular scale.
Okay.
The ways of representation will differ. Like if you can have a histogram for integer variables, but I mean, so ways of representation and ways of analysis will differ.
Okay. Next question is, can you explain the difference between ordinal and discrete variable again?
Yeah, so ordinal variable is a type of categorical variable. So it's when you're really really only interested in the name of the category, and the category name has an inherent hierarchy, but that's it. So just because I gave the example of 1 2 3 4 from the ranking, I mean that 1 2 3 4 is just a name. It could be A, B, C, D, or it could be X, Y, Z, etc. So what is important is the name of the category and the ranking. The number really doesn't matter. You can say richest, richer, poorest, poorer, that kind of thing also. Unfortunately, both my examples had 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as examples, but it's just a name with a hierarchy, so it can be heavy, heavier, heaviest, that kind of thing. And this other one, the discrete variable, is a numerical variable. You're counting something, but it can only take integer values, but you can do mathematical things with it. So you can say that if one room has 6 people and one room has 2 people, one room does have 3 times the number of people in the other rooms. So you can do other mathematical steps with it. The only thing is that it can't take any fraction values, like a continuous variable.
Right. Thank you, sir, for that. Our next question is, can you please explain the anti-Sherlock response again?
I mean, the anti-Sherlock response is completely my terminology. don't go on using it. But basically, it's so what we are doing in statistics is taking, in research, is taking a small sample, deciding what kind of sample to take, and then trying to extrapolate what we find from that particular sample. So if we take a sample of 10 people and say that so many and so many had that disease, and extrapolated that in the next 2 weeks in this particular neighborhood, 2% or 10% might have that disease. So what we are doing is taking particular facts that we found from data and extrapolating it into the world, or extrapolating it into general knowledge. Whereas what a deduction will do, what a detective will do, is completely the opposite. He has that case to solve, right? So then he says that it's evident that something, when tractors go on this mud road, you find this kind of wheel tracks, and all of every time I've seen a tractor go, I've seen this one. So in this particular situation, because I'm seeing this kind of wheel track, a tractor has gone through through here. So that is the kind of reverse reasoning that we are doing from a statistical point of view as compared to a detective, what he's doing. So deduction and induction are sort of kind of opposite, sort of kind of, not completely, but still.
So the last question is, how to choose which data is useful and valuable for our study?
So that depends on what question you're trying to answer. That only depends on what question you're trying to answer. So it's very important that you define the question first. So because that is how you will collect the data. So if you're trying to answer a question like prevalence of something, then the data will differ. If you're trying to, that you collect will differ. If you're trying to answer the causality of a drug in producing a certain adverse effect, that data will differ. So it will only depend on the question.
Okay. Yeah, all right. Thank you, sir. Okay. Sir, do you want to say something?
I've been saying something for the last...
No, like, I think that's it.
Okay.
Question answer session.
Okay, good. Anything you can, you're welcome to email me. I think you have my email number.
Yes, sir. If we get questions, we'll email them to you.
Yeah, sure.
So we thank you for a lot. Thank you for taking out time from your busy schedule and guiding us over this very fearful topic of biostatistics. Also, we thank Dr. Kinnikar ma'am for always being there for us and guiding us through all the events. I thank all the members of Research Council and all the teams, like technical team, publicity team, and all those who have helped in this. At the end, I'd like to thank the lovely audience for having so much patience and staying with us even during the technical issues. So thank you, everyone. And now I conclude the meeting. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.